Especially if you're a girl, opposition, and when you get a death penalty, that's so pain for you and for your family. To kill a virgin girl is sin. You have to sleep with her first and then kill her. Now the pain is after that, because in Islam is a religion of fear. You have to frighten every member of the family. That's why they're trying to frighten the world. And unfortunately, many Western people are afraid. Unfortunately, sadly. After killing that girl, you take the dress of that girl. That's your religious obligation. You need to do that. And you go and talk to her mom. You knock the door. I want to talk to this girl, mom. Mom comes there. You say, your girl was mine. I slept with her, we killed her, and this is the dress of your daughter. They broke the heart of many Iranian mothers. Were they Jews, Christians, Zoroastrians? No, Muslims. Islam, my friend, is a cruel religion. Even this slaughters Muslims. Many Muslims are here, even in this country. In other countries, they do not know that. When these leaders get to the power, they will kill first their own followers. Iranian government, Iranian system killed between 50 to 60,000 only young Iranian girls and boys. That's the prison I'm talking about. They shock you really with, you know, immoral words. They kidnapped me with my pajamas, you know. I'm sorry, they were just, you know, looking inside on my body and saying to me, who is going to sleep with your wife tonight? Because outside they show themselves righteous. Iranians really do not think that these people are rude that much. And they were two. One of them said, well, he's going to finish. It's you and me. That's the prison. From there, they took me to another prison with my four other friends. We were waiting in the death row with four other friends in a cell. All four were killed. And I could escape by the grace of God. It's a long story. It's a painful story too. If I say that to you, this section takes 1.5 hours. But I just simply say to you, by the grace of Jesus, I could escape. Even though I didn't know him. But he had a plan for me. You remember that ballad? And I have other stories, other prophecies, even Muslims prophesied. So I could escape the death penalty and from the country Iran to Turkey. In Turkey, I was a wandering man. I didn't know about my future. I started to learn the language and entered university to make myself busy. In the second year, I found a fellow Iranian man. He had business there. We became friends with each other. After a while, he invited me to put my money with his, make the capital larger. I did, but later, my friend took all my money and his, escaped to Germany. Another pain came to my life. I couldn't do anything because everything was written in his name. Now, he was going to a church there. He was not a Christian, he was Muslim. There was an Iranian Christian fellowship in Istanbul, in Turkey. Those Christians who were not able to live inside the country, Iran, after the Islamic Revolution, they escaped and they went to Turkey. And with some other foreign friends, American and European, they started a fellowship. And they having fellowship with each other and also working among Iranian refugees. They built friendship with many, and this man was one of them. He was going to that church sometimes. That caused me to go to that church to ask them why this happened to me. This man was coming here. He was my friend. He took all my money and escaped. For the first time in my life, I'm going to a church. Challenging and scary. Well, challenging because church is an unclean place. Scary is the, you know, was the strongest part. Now, I have escaped from the death penalty. Now I'm going to create another one for myself. Especially a politician like me, why you're going to a church? And especially in that area, there were very committed Muslim Turks there. Anyway, my money encouraged me to go in. I entered the church. I was shocked. People were playing music and they were singing inside the church. Music is evil in Islam. You remember just last year, the leader, Muslim leader here in Australia, said to the Muslim, withdraw your children from music class because it's evil. I was shocked. Now everybody was standing and singing. I said, I'm not going to stand to share this evil spirit with them. That's not Iranian, really. They stand with you. But I was afraid to stand with them. I said, no, I'm going to sit. I sat behind everybody, closer to the main door. I said, it's good to sit here. If something strange happens, easier to run out. That, again, is the mindset of committed Muslim and radical Muslim. You think that they are united with each other. Only fear is bringing them together. Uncertainty is everywhere there. Anyway, nothing happened inside the church. After the fellowship, they came and welcomed me very warmly. I said the story to them. They became so sad that I had lost the big money to a man who was sometimes going to that church. They promised me to help me. We can help you, they said. We have many friends in Germany. We are going to write to them to find this man and to beg him to give your money back. They encouraged me to go to the church. They said, if we get any response from them, we would be able to share that with you. After that, week after week, I went to the church. I never missed any Sunday for my money. Week after week, I saw these people are so nice people. My goodness. We call these people immoral people because Christians are the most immoral people in the world, in Islam. Is this immorality? This is so nice. We call these people ungodly, infidel, unclean people. I said, what a wonderful people these ungodly, unclean people are. They are sacrificially helping Muslims. We say, don't touch them. But not only they are touching us, they are sacrificing their time, their money for us. Their messages also were so powerful, my friend. I was teaching philosophy in Iran, and I was very much interested in Iranian poetry. In Iranian poetry, it encourages you to search for God in this world. I loved really to have God in my life. But for the first time, I was shaken by their messages. They said, we belong to the kingdom of God, not Satan anymore. God is mighty, isn't he? Every Muslim knows God is mighty. Can mighty God save? This is a powerful question you can ask, you know, people from every religious group. Is your God mighty? Why he is not able to save you here? If you call your mother and father, I need you, please come and help me. Do they ignore you? Why your God is not helping you to save you here? Why he is leaving you in uncertainty? What kind of God is this? We are saved. We are in the kingdom of God. If God is with you, who can be against you? Powerful stuff. It worked here. I loved it. But I didn't say to them, I love it. Because they had some ideas, I didn't like them. Jesus is God. Muslim scholars hate this. Quran hates that. They believe, Quran says, Christians have made a man as God for themselves. Quran doesn't know, Muhammad doesn't know, scholars, you know, do not know. It's not a man-made God. It's God who made himself a man. This is different philosophy. They said also, Jesus is the only way, only Savior. I said, this is selfish. What about others? Jesus is the Son of God. Oh, my goodness, this is the worst one. You're the worst of creatures. You go to hell and you have to be killed. They also spoke a lot about Jews. Open the Bible, read it, Jews, close it, Jews. I hated Jews. I said, what is wrong with these nice people? Beautiful people, funny ideas. I said, I'm going to help these people. These people are so nice people. They're going to get my money back. I have to pay back. This much I can't do. They're open people. That's good. You can criticize them. They do not kill you if you criticize them. Because if you criticize anybody in the Middle East, you're in problem. Quran, your fingers should be chopped first, and then your head. Chapter 8, verse 10 to 13. 33, 36. Nobody can speak above the words of Muhammad. So it has penetrated the life of people. Even for normal things, you cannot criticize each other. But these people, you can criticize them. I remember one day, I went to the pastor of the church. He was an American. I said to him, sir, I think you did a mistake. He said, just one? I do a lot of mistakes, he said. I was embarrassed. I said, wow. I was expecting him to say something, you know, aggressive to me. And he really was an humble man. He said, sir, thank you so much for reminding me, for telling me that. Could you do a favor to me? It's so hard to carry the mistakes with yourself. I just want to repent to God now. And he repented to God. You know, he's an old man. Iranian people respect really old people. It was so humbling to me. So that's why I said, I can't help these people. I can't go to them. I said, friends, you're nice people, but I think you're far behind. But glory to Jesus, they changed my life. Oh, my goodness. You know, the values of Jesus are so powerful. You just need to be a simple follower of Jesus Christ. So simply follow him to change the life of people. And these people were those people there, really. And if you're simple, he comes into your life in a mighty way, works through their life, you know, in your life. And he did. I was thinking to change them, they changed my life. And also Jesus was supernaturally working in my life. One night I had a dream. There was earthquake, fire everywhere, violent wind. I was in my father's house, exactly my father's house. So frightening. Houses were destroyed. People, died. I called God, please, God, do not leave me alone. I'm afraid. Please help me. In that time, a light appeared to me, said to me, I am Jesus. I will help you. Come out from your father's house. I rushed out. The house fell down. I woke up. I saw that was a dream. I couldn't sleep anymore. It was the middle of the night. Very painful. The following Sunday, I went to the church. I was amazed. A preacher was preaching there. The title of his message was, The House on the Rock of Jesus. In his message, he said everything I had seen in my dream, heard in my dream. Come out from your father's house. Come out from your old house. Live in the house that Jesus has built for you. Your father's house is the old tradition you have inherited from your forefathers. It's the house of pain. It's the house of sin. It's the house of hostility, ignorance, indifference. Every pain is coming from that house. Come out. Live in the house that Jesus has built for you. It's the house of absolute joy, absolute peace, absolute freedom. Jesus, like an eagle soaring on the high, because I saw him as a light there on the high. He's calling us, come to me. I will establish you on a higher ground. This is the ground of God. Satan cannot reach there. Come to him. Do not ignore him. Fully amazed and shocked. I said, what is this man talking about? This was my dream. In that day, I became interested to read their books. They gave me a New Testament. By reading that book, I was amazed. I was really amazed. Bible is an amazing book. Not because I'm a Christian, I'm saying that. Honestly, I'm saying to you. Because I've studied all other scriptures. This is an amazing book. It really changed whole dimension of my life. Destroyed my philosophy and planted this philosophy there. I discovered from the just first pages of the gospel that God in the Bible is a relational God. Jesus said the kingdom of God is in you. If God is not relational, how can he come in you? In philosophical language, it's called personal God. I didn't know there is one God who is personal. All gods are impersonal. Because they are impersonal, they do not have any attributes and personality in order to relate to other people, so they just stay away. That's why Muhammad didn't visit his God, because he is impersonal. But God here is relational. I was amazed, because gospel opened my eyes. If God is impersonal, how he can create a personal being? God must be personal in order to create personal being. By the way, impersonal gods do not reveal themselves. If someone does not reveal himself, how he is going to touch, take shape, dust and breathe in it and give it, you know, a living spirit? It was so powerful. Now, gospel is not saying this directly, but because I was teaching philosophy, it just was so powerful and amazing to me. Wow, wow, wow. Can I have God here? Gospel is saying that. Can I be with God? Can I be saved here? Can I get rid of the uncertainty? Muhammad died in uncertainty. Muhammad, the prophet of the so-called perfect religion. If religion is perfect, sir, why you died in uncertainty? But this tiny little community is saying to me, I am with God. I am with God. I was amazed doctrinally. I was reading Paul's words. In Romans chapter 5, he says, one man brought sin to this world. Oh, this is the yummiest part. One man brought sin to this world, whereas in all other religions, including Islam, gods brought sin to this world. What? Is there a God who does not touch sin, who does not create sin? That was powerful. And that chapter is a powerful chapter. Paul is a wonderful man, if I can say to you really dearly here. This man's philosophy and doctrine is so powerful. He is saying that through the sin of one man, all people were corrupted. Adam did sin, and sin came into the life of people. Therefore, through the life and through the work of a righteous one, all will be saved. You see, this is making sense. Because in all other religions, there is not any righteous one to send. Even gods are not righteous. If a God creates sin, can you call that God? Are you able to call that God a righteous God? No. If you touch sin, you live with sin, you create sin, you're not righteous. But this is a powerful chapter. One sinner made all people, led them astray. One righteous has come to take them. That it was powerful. It really touched my heart. Yeah. God is holy. He can save people. In other religions, if they have created sin, you cannot save people, because if there is not any essence of sin in you, how do you create sin? You have created sin, you're unrighteous. It was so powerful. If you're amazed doctrinally, if you're amazed philosophically, of course you'll be amazed socially, politically, morally too. I was really amazed. That's Jesus. He changes you in every dimension of your life. Socially, I discovered that I can love my wife. Love your wife? Oh my goodness, you better read the Quran about ladies to see really what kind of heartbreaking verses are there. Great scholars like Razi Sabzavari. Unfortunately, many of them are Iranian, Bukhari. Ladies are mute animal. You do not love animal. Possibly you Westerners do not understand it because you love your animals too. Gospel says, love your wife as love your body. The second wife is adultery. You just share the love with one. Oneness is so important in the love of Jesus Christ. And about his morality, I haven't got time to talk to you here. I'm saying to you, really, the values of Jesus are so powerful, especially younger people, you need to really learn this and amaze people. Morally, Islam thinks that Muslims are the best moral example for the world. Sir, if you're not saved, if you're not in the kingdom of God, how can you be a good example to other people? I am in the kingdom of God. I can be a good example to people. I am living with God. I am sharing the holiness of God. I am in the